All right. Good morning. My name is John Daly. I do teach at the University of Texas. I've taught there a long time. I teach a couple classes. One is an MBA class called Leadership Challenges. In that class, I'm interested in one very simple question. How come some people are more successful than other people within organizations? How come some people skyrocket to the top and other people get stuck in the middle? Now, let's be clear. Not everyone wants to succeed. Some simply want a job to be able to afford to live. But some want to climb that proverbial ladder of success. Footnote, there is no ladder. It's an extraordinarily greasy pole. Now, my methodology is very simple. I go to successful people and say, how come you're here? How come you're here and not somebody else? Now, some will say, I'm here because my mother created the company. Good answer. Some will say, well, no one else wanted this job. Somebody had to simply step up and take responsibility. I immediately go push it, because it'll be for 1 second anyone turns down a $35 million job and a Gulfstream 6 jet. Most look out the windows. They all have windows, by the way. And they say something like this. I had extraordinary vision. I can never help ask that moment, which drug? Because I had some good visions in college. I really did. But I wouldn't want to see over a major company have visions every day. If you have visions each day, you should be seeing a doctor. So once we get past all the BS, they begin to tell you really insightful and interesting things. For example, never take a job with a guy before he has done great. Follow a loser. No, seriously, poor Tim Cook at Apple. You gotta have sympathy for following Steve Jobs, right? Never join a successful project. Projects work on waves. If you join at the top of the wave, what happens? It crests. These guys have this almost sixth sense to join when there's a problem, fix it, ride it up, and get off right before it crests. A friend of mine in the music industry years ago said, always leave before the lights go on. Who's been to a concert, lights go on, everything just looks not so great anymore? Who's been in a bar in the daytime with lights on? It's disgusting. All right. Perhaps the single most important thing they all tell me is this, though. Stop negotiating with yourself. Every one of these people say the single biggest mistake most of us make is we literally talk ourselves out of opportunities. What's that mean? Who would like to buy a nice car if money were no issue whatsoever? Who would love to buy a nice car if money? Best car you can imagine. What would it be, sir? Aspirational. Go for it. A what? A Rolls Royce, very good. Now, I'm a professor. I'll never know what a Rolls Royce costs. I'm sure you know. What's the best Rolls Royce in the world cost? What do you think? Estimate.
Half a million.
Well, your organization has an extraordinary year. We're talking extraordinary. They give out huge bonuses. You get a bonus of $400,000 in cash in a paper sack. Now, you're driving home that night. You go right by a near neighborhood Rolls dealership. I'm sure you have a few in your neighborhood. You see the car of your dream with 500K open in the window. What's the mistake most of us make? We keep driving, we don't have the money. What do every one of these successful people say you must do every time? Walk in with that paper sack of money, I got 400K, do you want to give me the car for that amount of money? Now, most of the time I'll laugh and kick you out. But who knows, they haven't sold a car for the last 3 weeks. A new model's coming in next month. Look, I can 100% guarantee you won't get the car if you don't go in. At least a small chance of getting the car if you walk in. The mistake most of us make, these execs tell me, is this. We're simply afraid to make the ask. So I give my MBA students an assignment. They hate it the first few weeks. They come to like it by the end. In fact, it's going to be an assignment for you as well. Once a week for the next year, ask for something you're absolutely sure you cannot get. Okay, and embarrass your kids, but they'll get used to it very quickly. Who enjoys restaurants? Who enjoys eating out? Next three times you're at a restaurant, ask for something not on the menu. Look, they have a kitchen, they have a cook, they have food, they can probably do it right. Who goes out sometimes? You're simply not that hungry. Ask for the kid's plate. No one's going to ID you to make sure you're under 12. All right? Next time you're at a hotel, ask for a better room. Next time you're at an airport, ask for a better seat. I mean, what's the worst they're going to say? No. Who's happily married here? You used to know. Embrace it. All right? If you don't ask, it's simply not going to happen. But the mistake we make is if we want the training, if we want the trip, if we want the deal, we got to make the ask. And too many people are afraid to make the ask. Now, some of these behaviors we've discovered are what we call asymmetric behaviors. Do them right, no one even notices. Do them wrong, they become potential dramas. For example, let's imagine we meet for the first time. What do we normally say when we meet somebody the first time? What do we say? Nice to what? Nice to meet you. Never again as long as you live. Who's made the mistake of saying nice to meet you and somebody says, don't you remember, went to school together, hooked up last week? It comes back to haunt you, doesn't it? What do execs always say? What do top leaders always say? Never nice to meet you. What do they say instead? Nice to see you. Good to see you. Look, they can't remember everyone, but everyone remembers them. Nice to meet you is going to get you in trouble at some point. In fact, who's had that experience? Who said nice to meet you and somebody says, don't you remember? You feel awkward afterwards. What's another one like this? Never ask about people's families or their jobs when you haven't seen somebody for a while. Who's been embarrassed before? You know, how are you doing? How is your family doing? My wife left me 6 weeks ago. You don't need that drama. You don't care that much. What do you say instead? What's new in your world? What's up? It works as well. We call them asymmetric. You do them right, no one even notices. You do them wrong, they become potential dramas. Now, every one of these leaders tell me the single biggest challenge they face is to try to influence people. How many of you figured out the soft skills are the hard skills in leadership? Okay? The technical skills are straightforward. It's relatively straightforward, a checklist. The hard skills is getting people to want to do what you need them to do. How do you influence a client? How do you influence a customer? How do you influence people in the job? That is the number one challenge of every leader. And if they're not good at it, there are serious consequences. A guy named Richard Pels, actually Purdue University, a number of years ago discovered something. My satisfaction with my boss is deeply tied to my belief that he has influence with his boss. If I think my boss doesn't know how to influence, is incapable of influencing, I'm not happy working for them. On the other hand, my boss is very influential, I'm much happier working for them. So not only do we get our jobs done through influence, we also get people to want to work with us. Safety is about influence when you think about it. Indeed, everything you do in your job revolves on influence. So we're going to spend just a short time today talking about what it takes to successfully get buy-in for yourself and for your ideas. We're going to use a very simple model, a very straightforward model of influence. It's a four-step model. It works every time. First, if you want to influence people, create a need. The secret of getting somebody to change is some need. There's a wonderful phrase, no pain, no change. All right? If everything's fine, why do you want to change anything? If things are running perfectly, why fool with it? Who has a good life right now? How many of you have great lives right now? Why mess with it? If it gets bad enough, you'll do something. Now, how do we create a sense of pain when we want to influence? Simple model, answer the why now question. You go home after this conference, discover your family's moving to no forwarding address. You go to your job, that crack security team will not let you in. You call up one of your best friends, they hang up on you immediately. Your car gets stolen, your house gets repossessed. One day you find a side to see a therapist. What's the first question, actually the second question your therapist asked? The first is how you're gonna pay. But the second is gonna be what? Why do you wanna see me today? In medicine, it's called the presenting problem. If everything is going well, why do anything? You see your doctor only when you're feeling ill. You know how to freak out your doctor? Schedule an appointment. Walk in. Physician says, why are you here? You say, I have nothing else today. I like those six-month-old magazines in your lobby. They send you to the psychiatrist. You've always got to create a why now first. Now, we oftentimes recommend using what we call a SWOT analysis for the why now. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Of those four, what gets decision makers' attention most? Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, or threats? What do you think it is? Threats, absolutely. Threats get people's attention. There's an infinite number of threats, but if you don't have a threat, people are simply not going to change. What are some potential threats? Introductions and new substitutes. How many know what Splenda is? Fake sugar, right? NutraSweet owned that marketplace for 20 years. Splenda comes in, now we gotta do something. Foreign competitors can be a huge why now. New materials can be a why now. If you want to persuade people, you first of all got to create some pain. And the way you create the pain is by answering the why now question. Then what you want to do is offer a plan. Now, here's the biggest mistake most of us make. We offer a plan before we create a need. And we always get shot down. Who's seen somebody walk in a meeting and say, I want to do this? And people say, we don't have the time. We don't have the budget. We don't have the people. And they're getting defensive. Let me explain why. You always create the pain, and then you resolve the pain. Your doctor never recommends treatment until she's explained your malady. They always talk about what's wrong and say, here's what we're going to do about it. Never present your proposal before you created a sense of need at the beginning. Then you want to show people benefits. Benefits are crucial. Certainly, I want to resolve the need, but I want to get some benefits as well. How do we demonstrate benefits? Let me give you just one broad technique today. Be able to answer what we call the WIF IT question. WIF IT stands for what? What's in it for them? Not what's in it for me, but what's in it for them. Couple observations about WIF ITs. Number one, your WIF IT won't be their WIF IT. When you were kids, you liked Skittles. Thus, what'd you buy your mother for her birthday? Of course you bought Skittles. Who's figured out that maybe your mom doesn't actually like Skittles? Maybe she likes something else. You gotta think what matters to them, not what matters to you. What's a good case this? How many have been married in the last 15, 20 years? How many of you, when you did your wedding, you created a registry? And you listed the things you wanted. How many of you were absolutely astounded by what some of your friends bought you? You said you wanted blue towels, and you showed up with an orange towel instead. How is that possible, right? Just because they like it doesn't mean you're going to like it. You've got to figure out what the other person, what the WIF IT is for them as opposed for yourself. Secondly, every person may have a different WIF IT than another person. In a room of a couple hundred people, there may be 50 or 60 different WIF ITs. Really smart people figure out what each person's WIF IT is before they even go to the meeting. So what are some potential WIF ITs? Some people love their organization. Who loves the company you work with? Who loves your company? And the tattoo is located where? All right. Understand some people care about the reputation of the company. Other people care about making or saving money. Some people like to be efficient. Some people like to be famous. Expertise is figuring out each person's WIF IT. Understanding no two people may have the same WIF IT. Who has more than one child? How many of you are regularly amazed that it came from the same genetic pool? Who is a brother or sister? You know you're not related to, but you're afraid to ask. You gotta be very savvy about figuring out each person's WIF IT. Now, I wanna do a little exercise right now. I want you to try to guess a person's WIF IT, okay? This is from an event that happened in New York City back in the 1980s, I believe, all right? Some of you may recollect this. There was this infestation of pestilence that came to New York City, all right? There was a small vendor who said, we think we have a way of actually getting rid of this pestilence. All right? The mayor wasn't that interested. The mayor's assistant, in fact, hated the small vendor. These guys got a chance to meet with the mayor just for a few minutes in a meeting one day. And they had the chance to kind of convince the mayor to use their services. I want you to watch this video because I want you to try to guess for me at the end, what's the WIF IT that finally gets the mayor's attention? There's going to be about 20 or 25 different WIF ITs. You try to figure out the WIF IT that gets the mayor's attention. For one of my favorite movies.
Here, John, what is this? All I know is that was no light show we saw this morning.
I've seen every form of combustion known to man. But this beats the hell out of me.
The walls in the 53rd precinct were bleeding. How do you explain that?
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Oh, your eminence.
Oh. How are you, Lenny?
You're looking good, Mike. We're in a real fix here. Mm-hmm. What do you think I should do?
Lenny, officially, the church will not take any position on the religious implications of these phenomena. Mm. Personally, Lenny, I think it's a sign from God. But don't quote me on that.
No, I think that's a smart move, Mike.
Well, I'm not going to call a press conference and tell everyone to start praying.
I'm Winston Zeddemore, Your Honor. Look, I've only been with the company for a couple of weeks. But I gotta tell you, these things are real. Since I joined these men,
I have seen shit.
Well, you could believe Mr. Pecker.
My name is Peck.
Or you could accept the fact that this city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
What do you mean, biblical?
What he means is Old Testament, Mr.
Yes.
Mayor. Real wrath of God type stuff.
Exactly.
Fire and brimstone coming down from the skies. Rivers and seas boiling.
40 years of darkness, earthquakes, volcanoes.
The dead rising from the grave. Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together. Mass hysteria.
Enough, I get the point. What if you're wrong?
If I'm wrong, nothing happens. We go to jail, peacefully, quietly. We'll enjoy it. But if I'm right, then we can stop this thing. Lenny, you will have saved the lives of millions of registered voters.
I don't believe you're seriously considering listening to these men.
Get him out of here.
Bye. I'll fix you, Venkman. I'm gonna fix you.
I'm gonna get you a nice fruit basket. I'm gonna miss him.
All right. We got work to do. Now, what do you need from me?
Now, what got the mayor's attention most? Blood pouring from walls, dogs and cats living together, a sign from God? No. What got the mayor's whiffet? Voters! When you find the right whiffet, everyone pays attention. Everyone understands why it's important. Trust me, not everyone cares about saving money. Not everyone cares about reputation. You gotta figure out each person's whiffet individually. Now, how do you figure out people's whiffets? We've asked this question over the last few years. We've gone to a lot of very successful people and said, what's your secret about reading people? In a meeting, how do you read what actually matters to each person? Let me give you a few things they've told us. Number one, listen to what people complain about. Whatever you complain about, everyone in this world tells me what's important to you. If I say no one's organized, everyone's messy, everyone's cluttered, no one takes care of property, what matters to me? Be a neat, organized person. No one's low anymore. Everyone flips jobs every 6 months, it seems. No one sticks to any project any longer. What matters? Loyalty to me. You can simply listen to how they complain about things to figure out the whiffet. Number two, remember this. In every meeting, any question is actually a statement. People don't ask questions randomly. They're trying to communicate what matters to them by the questions they ask. If I always ask questions about the numbers, I'm a number kind of person. If I always ask questions about how it's going to affect people, I'm kind of an HR kind of person. You can learn by people's questions. Thirdly, look at the way they decorate. Who's gone to somebody's home and everything suddenly makes good sense? Once you see how they decorate, they tell you what matters over a period of time. If you have hundreds of diplomas in your wall, you're telling me education matters. If you have hundreds of pictures of your kids, you're telling kids matter. You can at least look at how they live and you can figure out what matters to them. Fourth, look for atypical behavior. Look, we're all dressed basically the same here today, all right? Business, kind of business to business casual. If one guy came in flip-flops, a kind of Hawaiian shirt, cut-off pants, and he came every day that way, we know what matters to him, wouldn't we? I can't tell what matters to you by your appearance because we all have the same uniform on. But if I do something distinctive, that tells me what matters to you over a period of time. Fourth observation about whiffets. You've got to bring home the so what of the whiffet. Simply telling people we can solve something, all right, we got a solution for you, is not enough. You've got to also bring home what that solution means for people. So this was at ExxonMobil stations about 4 years ago now. Said if every U.S. driver had properly inflated tires, over 700 million gallons of gasoline would be saved every year. How many of you need to go out and check your tire pressure right now? No. What should they have said instead? How much you would save, right? But that's the whiffet. But the so what that comes with that whiffet is what you could actually do with that money. That's what really matters to people. So politicians never say, vote for me, I'll reduce taxes. Vote for me, I'll reduce taxes, you'll be able to afford your children's school fees. If I reduce taxes, you'll be able to buy that boat you've always wanted to buy. You can't simply give somebody a whiffet. You've got to tell people what that whiffet does for them over a period of time. Now, I'm going to give you a classic example of this, probably from the best sales movie ever made in history. If you want to learn how to sell better, simply watch this movie 4 or 5 times, and you'll become a better salesperson. I can't help but like 80s humor. Tommy Boy's coming up. All right? Who's seen Tommy Boy? Now, David Spade is going to be in this movie. He's going to describe the whiffet, okay? Tommy's going to actually sell his idea by telling people the so what of the whiffet. See what's more persuasive.
Well, then, I'd just like to add that the spectrometer readout on the nickel-cadmium alloy mix indicates a Goodrich strobe and fade, decreasing incidence of wear to the pressure plate. If you could just...
Whoa, little fella, you're not speaking my language.
What my associate is trying to say is that, our new brake pads are really cool. You're not even going to believe it. Like, let's say you're driving along the road with your family, and you're driving along, la la la, woo, and then all of a sudden there's a truck tire in the middle of the road, and you hit the brakes. Whoa, that was close. Now let's see what happens when you're driving with the other guy's brake pads. You're driving along, and all of a sudden the kids are yelling from the back seat, I gotta go to the bathroom, Daddy. Not now, damn it. Truck tire. I can't stop. Help! There's a cliff. And your family's screaming, oh my God, we're burning alive. No, I can't feel my legs. In comes a meat wagon. And the medic gets out and says, oh my God. New guy's in the corner puking his guts out. All because you want to save a couple extra pennies.
You always have to bring home the so what of anything you're talking about. If people don't see a so what, they're not going to pay much attention. You're not building a building, you're building shelter. You're doing something that's giving people a safe environment to work in. You give them an excuse to be away from home, whatever. You always got to bring something home if you're doing a whiffet. Final thing about whiffets is this. To the degree that everyone has different whiffets, it is always more successful to sell an idea one-on-one, door-to-door, than in a meeting. The mistake we make is we try to sell things in meetings. The effective person always does what we call pre-selling. They work door-to-door, get buy-in from each person, even before the meeting happens. How many have seen this happen before? How many have seen somebody go to a meeting and they get beat up on lots of things? Another person who walks in and proposes something, everyone nods their head. The latter person successfully pre-sold this idea. They got buy-in before the meeting for their idea. In fact, I'd argue at the top of most companies, meetings don't really matter that much because everything's been sold one-on-one ahead of time. You knew this as kids. Who had brothers or sisters? How many understand you pre-sold your idea, didn't you? You got your brother or sister degree initially, and then you had to go to your parents. But no one ever goes to both parents at the same time. Typically, in the American family, people always go to their dads because dads generally abdicate any responsibility for making decisions at home. Dad, what do you think about this? What does every dad say? Whatever your mother says is fine with me. So what happens? As soon as dad says this, the kid runs to mom and says, Mom, dad has this fantastic idea. You don't want to sell to your parents together. You want to sell door-to-door, one-on-one, don't you? Now, the final step in this model of influence is probably the most recent one we discovered. Listen to this carefully. People fear regret more than they're excited by opportunity. We're more afraid of losing something than we're excited about getting something. Losing $50 on the street is more emotionally painful than finding $50 on the street is exciting. We are basically risk-averse species. We don't want to lose things, and losing hurts a lot. See, in any presentation when you're trying to pitch an idea, by simply saying, if we don't do this now, we won't get a second chance. Companies acquire other companies, not necessarily because they want the company. They want to make sure no one else gets that company. Energy companies lease huge bodies of water in the Gulf of Mexico, not to explore. But why? If they give that lease up and somebody else gets the lease and they discover billions of barrels of oil, they're going to be really upset, aren't they? So always any pitch, you won't get a second chance. This is the only chance you have. And you talk about what happens if they don't do it in terms of loss. Now, who took an economics class in college? Who took economics in college? Who remembers your professor leaning over a podium and saying, assuming a perfectly rational human being? Now, economics for 300 years assumed people were rational. But we know people are not rational. We know they're not rational. So when it comes to influencing skills, economists have discovered a number of ways people are irrational, but consistently irrational in the last 20 years. We call these heuristics, how people behave consistently, but not necessarily logically. And if you want to influence people in any of these steps, you need to understand these heuristics. Let me give you a few examples today. One is called the vividness bias. People will overweight vivid information every time. People overweight things that come to mind quickly as opposed to things that are logical. What's the case in point in terms of this? How many people died on US highways last year? What do you think? What's the number? How many people died on US highways last year? 46,000 people. How many people died at terrorism events in the last 15 years? United States, almost none. We spent $4 trillion on safety and security in terms of terrorism. We spent nothing on highway safety. Why? How many said terrorism gets our attention, doesn't it? Accidents, safety incidents. We tend to overweight those vivid ones and ignore the everyday ones that are actually good predictors of future problems, don't we? You see, we're not good statisticians. We overweight some things and ignore other things. Let's try this as an exercise right now. Everyone pick up your pens right now if you have one and write down your favorite three letters in the English alphabet. Just jot down your favorite three letters in the English alphabet. Write them down right now, your favorite three letters. By the way, don't write A, B, C, or X, Y, Z. Be a little bit thoughtful. Think, what truly are my favorite letters in the English alphabet? That's why you want university professors who ask you questions you never thought about before. Got them down? Now do me a favor. Circle those letters you wrote down that also appear in your name. Now raise your hand right now if you have more than one letter written down that appears in your name. I would say about two-thirds of the room. Who has two or more letters written down that appear in your name? I would say we're about half the room. Now that defies statistical odds. You see, we don't think of letters randomly. We think of the ones that come to mind first, don't we? And those in your name come to mind first. Let's see if this works. Do me a favor. How many have E down as a favorite letter? Raise your hand if E is a favorite letter. I can see one person, two, three, four, five, maybe six of you. Who has J as a favorite letter? Raise your hand. There are far more J's than E's. Now that defies odds. E is the most common letter in the English alphabet, and J is the third least common letter. So how come we have more J's than E's? Partly because of names. There are a number of reasons that one is names. 30, 50 years ago, with a lot of E names. Who remembers Esther, Edith, Edwin, Eric, okay, Edward? Those names are gone. There's still lots of J names. They come to mind quicker. You see, we're not good statisticians. What we are is we actually focus on vivid, the most memorable moments, if that makes sense. So how do we use this when we're trying to persuade people, aside from giving people vivid examples? Little technique I want to use in the future. How many recognize your industry? Everything revolves around numbers. Numbers are part of every part of your business, aren't they? From this day forward, you're never going to give somebody a number without giving them a vivid equivalency of that number. So I do a program like this for NASA. It's a day-long program. I do it 6 or 7 times a year. Eleanor Chair runs Johnson Space Center in charge of manned space for the United States, all right? She's a former astronaut, was up 4 times, ran the astronaut corps for a while. I asked her one time how fast the space shuttle flew in space. John, we go 17,600 miles per hour. That is really fast, I said. She says, it's incredibly fast. You have no idea what it means. I said, none whatsoever. John, we see a sunrise and a sunset every 45 minutes. What got my attention more? Sunrise, sunset, right? Give people an equivalence they can identify with. Let me give you an example. Any of you heard of the Center for Science in the Public Interest? It's a group in DC that wants to advocate better eating habits. They want us to eat healthier foods. They went after dessert foods a few years ago. How many know, for example, what cheesecake factory cheesecake is? 710 calories, 49 grams of fat, equal to a pizza, personal pan, pepperoni pizza, plus 2 entire Dairy Queen banana splits. Who says well worth it? Okay, Mrs. Fields double fudge brownies. 420 calories, 25 grams of fat, equal to 2 slices of Domino's extra cheese pepperoni plus 2 pats of butter. Cinnabon muffins, my favorite, all right? 670 calories, 34 grams of fat, equal to McDonald's Big Mac, plus a hot touch Fundy. What gets your attention more, calories and fat or the equivalencies? Give some an equivalency, they get it right away. So from this day forward, never give somebody a number when you're trying to persuade them without giving them a vivid equivalency. Another thing we've discovered in the heuristics area in the last 20 years is an absolutely wonderful concept. It's called nudging. Nudging. Nudging says, how do we get people to want to do something as opposed to have to do something? Who's been to Schiphol Airport, Amsterdam's airport? Anybody been to Amsterdam's airport? You wouldn't know this. Every male would know this in this room. In every urinal in Schiphol's airport, they painted a fly on the urinal. Why do they put a fly in every urinal? Target. You thought we are simple as a species, now you know males are simple. All right? Give anyone a target, they cannot help but hit that target. Who has little boys right now? Who has little boys? On your way home, stop at Target, buy some Fruit Loops. Number one, your boy will try to hit it, and you'll try to flip it. All right? Understand it's a simple case. They could have singing and pouring police that'll arrest you if you miss. They could have big neon signs aimed correctly. All they simply paint a fly on the urinal, and it works. You want to do it as opposed to having to do it. Nudging happens in every part of our lives. Let me share a case of this. Who's been to Germany? Who's been to Austria? Close enough. In Germany, they have a 12% organ donation rate. In Austria, they have a 99% organ donation rate. Why do Austrians donate their organs much more than Germans? Maybe you know why that is? It's something called default. In Germany, they assume you don't want to donate unless you say you do. In Austria, they assume you want to donate unless you say you don't. Most states in the United States assume you don't want to do it unless you say yes, right? How many of us in Austria, the Netherlands, have proven that if you simply change it to make the assumption that people want to donate, you get a lot more donations, don't you? It's called default. HR has done this nowadays. You don't have to choose things. They give you the package automatically, don't they? You assume that's the default. If you want to take things away, you have to argue. If you had people ask, do you want health insurance, life insurance, all these things one by one, people say, I don't need that, I don't need that. So you get the package instead. It's called the default option. And it gets people to do more of what you want, and they just assume they're supposed to do it that way. Let me give you a couple examples in the construction industry. How many have seen some of these design models recently? How many know what the Camden bench is, for example? Camden bench was originally in Camden, New Jersey, all right? What these are benches by basically bus stops, for example. They're no longer flat. They actually angle a little bit in both directions, like a steeple of a church in some ways. Why do they do that? You can't sleep on it. You can sit there for a while, but people aren't going to sleep on that bench. Does that make sense? It's a simple nudge. They don't have to say, please don't sleep on the bench. They simply what? Design the bench so you can't sleep on it. But it's still comfortable if you're waiting for 10 minutes for the bus. What happens? You don't want people to skateboard on your wall. What do you do? Put these very attractive little metal things every so often. You don't have a sign, no skateboarding anymore. You don't have to have a security guy say, don't skateboard. You simply can't do it. Same with these what? The decorative disruptions. What they do is they preclude people from doing something without even asking them. They simply won't do it. You nudge people to do it. One of my favorite examples of nudge happened in Sweden about 15, 20 years ago now. It was a pilot, and it worked extraordinarily well. It's also a very cute exercise.
Thank you.
I mean, that's a wonderful example. You see, there's design things definitely. Give Sweden a hand. All right? How do you use nudging? What are some hacks you can use every day for nudging? Thinking ethically. One study done at the University of North Carolina was fascinating. They had people lie about things. You can set it up so people are lying. It's a very interesting experimental methodology. They had people lie about something. But for half the people, they had them simply say the words 10 commandments before they lied. Those people are far less likely to lie than the person who did not hear the word 10 commandments. Somebody hearing 10 commandments sometimes nudges us to be more honest. Who wants to exercise more? Who needs to exercise more? Don't go to the fanciest gym, go to the nearest gym. You may want to go to LA Fitness, but you have to get in your car and drive for 20 miles. Go to that smelly gym right down the street. It's easier when you think about it. Move to a neighborhood with sidewalks. New York City is in surprisingly good shape. Houston, Texas. Who's from Houston here? Be proud. You're the third most obese city in America. Now, I had a knee replacement about 3 years ago, so I can't run any longer. So I've had to start walking a lot. I've been stopped by cops 3 times in Houston. Are you okay, sir? Yes, I am. Do you remember your name? I do. All right. What are you doing? I'm walking. One cop says, sir, no one walks in Houston. One reason is Houston lacks sidewalks compared to many other cities. If you want people to exercise more by walking, put sidewalks up, it's safer. You want to lose weight? Who wants to lose weight? On your way home, go to Target, buy smaller plates. The secret of frozen food is what? Small servings, isn't over a period of time. Never go shopping on an empty stomach. Never eat standing up in the kitchen. Always sit down and put things on plates. Who can finish a pint of ice cream as you stand talking to your spouse in the kitchen? If you are forced to what? Either A, put it in a bowl, you eat less, or alternatively, buy the mini containers, aren't they? Settings, if you want to be more efficient, choose one place for each thing to do. Your mind goes to that. Sleeping, for example, one trick with sleeping, get rid of your phone and replace it with an alarm clock. How many understand every time your phone goes at night, it kind of worries you and interrupts you in some ways. What's another sleeping technique? Only use your bed for sleeping. Don't watch movies, don't work in your bed. Train your mind to only use your bed for sleeping. Shopping lists actually help you save money. We discovered it's a nudge. Gosh, who has trouble getting people out of your office? I'll give you a simple nudge. Get rid of the chairs. They can't sit down. If you can't get rid of the chairs, what do? Put hard chairs as opposed to soft chairs. How many seen someone walk in your office, it's a soft chair, they make fit themselves in that chair, they're never going to leave. One trick, as soon as they walk in the office, stand up. All these are examples of little nudges you can do to get behavior. Let me demonstrate this as a group exercise right now. I want each of you to find a partner. Somebody sitting next to you, behind you, say, you're my partner. Everyone gets a partner. Okay. I want one person each partnership to say, I am partner A. One person be A in each partnership. A's, raise your hand like this. A's, raise your hand like this. A's, make a tight fist like this, please. A's, take the tight fist and put it close to the face of partner B. Dream come true in a few cases, it appears. Keep the fist up there. Now, B, your job. Get A's fist open as fast as you can. Get that fist open. Get the fist open. Get it open. Stop, stop, stop. Release. Let him go. Free him. How many of you turned to your partner and said, would you please open your fist? You need summer school. We need a whole day for this program, all right? The first time that is your influencing skills, how many of you want to violence and force? But what happened when you tried to force the fist open? It got what? Tighter. Make my day. Why not ask first? You can always torture later on. Now, I did this a number of years ago in Washington, D.C. with a very fancy group of people. When we did this exercise, one guy was absolutely brilliant, a guy named Ron Brown. I doubt you remember Ron Brown. He was Secretary of Commerce of the Clinton administration. We did this exercise. He didn't force the fist open. He didn't beg to get the fist open. He turned to his partner and said, what would it take for you to want to open that fist for me? I thought it was brilliant. Rather than forcing, rather than begging, why don't we try seduction? No, you've been out of town too long. All right. Now, who's had a great boss or a great teacher at least once in your life? You didn't want to disappoint them. When I work with safety with a couple construction companies, okay, understand, how do I get people to want to be safe as opposed to have to be safe? See the difference there? Regrettably, most companies focus on how do we force people to be safe. Question I want to ask is how do we design so people can't hurt themselves? How do we get them to want to be safe? That's what influence is all about. I wish we had more time, but we need to stop now for questions, all right? Are there any questions? What are your questions? Here's my handy guy with his little phone reading out questions.
Yes, there's plenty of questions. So again, I appreciate everyone asking. We do have time for a few questions. And again, I continue to encourage you to keep putting the questions into the app. If you don't get them answered here, again, there's the opportunity to get out and meet John at the VIP booth. So the first question is, how does one's personal credibility factor into their ability to influence a situation?
Credibility matters immensely. There's a wonderful phrase. You can never separate the dance from the dancer. You may simply not be the right person to pitch an idea. People don't trust you, don't believe you're competent, don't like you. It's really hard when you're not seen as credible. Now, we spend a lot of time asking the question, what makes somebody credible? Part of trust, for example, trust is absolutely key, isn't it? If I lose trust, I don't get it back in. So we've actually spent a lot of time trying to figure out what creates the perception of trust in people. Let me give you one principle we discovered. Learn to master your small commitments. It's the cornerstone of credibility. I've been lucky to work with the Bank of Montreal for probably the last 20 years doing a program on leadership. Bank of Montreal is odd enough headquartered in Toronto. You must appreciate Toronto Canadian politics. I go up there probably once a quarter to this program. When I first started doing it probably 20 years ago, I did a series of them very quickly. I get back to Austin. I get a phone call one day. Are you John Daly? Yes, I am. The guy does BMO programs. I said, yes, I am. He says, why don't you do a second program for us? I said, wait a minute, who are you? Oh, my name's Jock such and such. I'm chief administrative officer of the company. What do you have in mind? He says, well, John, I have a problem. Right now, there are probably 3,000 banks in Canada, maybe more than that. In 10, 15 years' time, there are going to be 6 or 7 dominant banks. In 40 years' time, there are going to be 2 or 3 dominant banks. If we don't grow quickly, we're going to lose. I want my people to think bigger. They don't think globally. They don't think nationally. They think provincially or in terms of their town or city. I said, I don't think you want a program. You want more of a seminar. He says, that's what I want. Can you do that? I am a professor. I do seminars. He said, well, when do you want to do it? I said, hold on. Before we do the seminar, I want to meet with you, make sure we're aligned. Great. When are you going to be up here again? So I'll be up actually in about 4 weeks on Thursday. Why don't we have lunch that day? He pauses and says, John, I'm on holiday that entire week. Can you come up earlier? I go, sure, I'm actually free this Thursday. Brilliant. Wednesday night, meet me at Tim Hortons by the bank, 6 o'clock Thursday morning. Tim Hortons, Dunkin' Donuts on steroids. We're supposed to meet for 20 minutes. The conversation goes for almost an hour. This guy is absolutely brilliant, all right? He's not simply book brilliant, but he's savvy brilliant, smart about people. I'm entranced. At one point, he says, remind me again where you teach. I said, the University of Texas, the school in Austin. I said, yes, indeed. He says, you know, I believe my niece went to school there. I said, really? Perhaps she had your class. I said, I don't know, there's 53,000 students there. I will check, he says. Well, I go to Pearson Airport afterwards. He soon goes back to work. Friday morning, I get this express mail envelope from him. Open it up, little card inside. John, splendid chatting with you. Send proposal immediately. Want to approve before going on holiday? Best, Jacques. Down the bottom, P.S. Talk to my niece after lunch. She did have your class, enjoyed it. Good job. Now, he's even talking about, because that was 10 seconds in the middle of a 1 hour conversation. About 11 o'clock, I finally figured he was talking about, so I rang him up on the phone. Jacques, thanks for the card. He says, no problem. I have no choice anyway. What do you mean I have no choice? He says, my grandmother would never give us presents. We write thank you notes, so I got in the habit of doing it. No, I think the thing I like most was thinking about your niece. I totally forgot on that. He said, John, you asked me a question. Why was I so successful? I thought about this as we were talking. And I think I was successful in my career because I learned the value of small commitments. Keeping big commitments is a basic job requirement. What people know is when you keep the itty-bitty, tiny commitments, they never anticipate keeping in the first place. He went on and said, I've reached the point where I make commitments just so I can keep them. How many has a lot of wisdom about that in terms of credibility? People notice your small commitments. The worse the traffic is, no more people notice when you're on time for a meeting. Am I right about that? Small commitments build your credibility more than anything else.
John, we're actually probably going to hit our timing because we do need to get set up for the next presentation. So with that, I thank you. It was a great speech. And
thank you.